Hello, this is Dr. Paul McDermid. This video lecture has been developed for Massey University's Athletic Training and Conditioning course. The purpose of the session is to show understanding of a sport and its application to developing training guidelines and formulating a training plan. Before we can devise a training program for a sport, we have to have a good understanding of the requirements of that sport. This part of the lecture will give a brief overview of what we know. A slalom competition requires paddlers to negotiate a set course of between 18 and 25 gates as quickly as possible. Gates consist of two poles suspended above the water. The poles are colour-coded based on the direction the paddler must pass through the gate. Green gates mean the paddler must pass through in a downstream direction, while red gates must be passed through in an upstream direction. Hitting a gate incurs a 2-second penalty, while missing a gate incurs a 50-second penalty. Okay, you understand a bit about the rules that govern the sport. I was going to show a video of Mike Dawson at the 2000 Olympics here, but the YouTube version was blocked. Nevertheless, I'll show the winner of the 2016 World Cup in Pau, France, the site of the 2007 World Champs. Excuse any references to Mike. We have already identified that the outcome of this sport is dependent on the total time to negotiate the course, including any penalties gained on the way down. In order to be able to devise a training plan for such sports, you need to know about the intensity, the duration, the muscular contractions that are occurring, and how all of these factors interact with the skill required. Therefore, the first thing to consider is how quickly the paddler gets the boat up and running to an optimal speed. The paddler needs to develop technique to maintain this speed in the white water with minimal effort. However, as you can see, the course and the features of the river make this difficult. As such, canoe slalom is classified as an intermittent sport. The art of being a world-class athlete is to make something very difficult look particularly easy, as demonstrated by Mike on this particular run. Once the boat is up and running, forwards paddling requires low forces with the arms being moved at reasonably high velocities. But as you'll notice, the boat is very rarely going in a straight line, and all of these correction or turning strokes require high forces at low velocity. It is these low force technical manoeuvres where time is typically lost and gained. While skill, potentially defined as the choice of strokes or the strokes used and the boat position, is the main determinant of the paddler's position while negotiating the course, it is the physical components of strength or strength endurance as the paddler progresses down the course that enables this to occur. Additionally, strength gained through training also enables paddlers to correct for mistakes that they make while they're on the course. It is important not to isolate the technical, physical, physiological and psychological aspects of this sport, but rather to understand how all aspects are integrated into a typical training plan and or one training session. Scientific literature on this sport is scarce, yet many paddlers or coaches have systems in place to monitor fitness and or performance. As you can see from Zampiro's basic descriptive work in 2005 on some of the top Italian paddlers, competition runs can be classified as very hard physically. Throw in thought processes and the technical element makes for very interesting ingredients list, where the quantities have to be judged to perfection. The graph here shows that oxygen demand is high from the outset, but as you can see, it takes about 60 seconds to get to the required or maximal capacity. This highlights a large anaerobic or oxygen debt component to the sport. Pushing too hard early on, however, could lead to drastic consequences later in the run. Up until more recently, there have been limited and or only non-commercial methods to quantify work rate with regards to performance. As such, our ability to fully understand the sport has been rather limited. However, the advancement of microtechnology with wireless functionality has led to commercial development of the slalom paddle power meter. For more information on this, visit onegiantleap.co.nz. In helping develop this product for slalom kayaking, we've been able to explore some of the physical aspects of the sport in relation to the technical and physiological demands. Firstly, we identified that work rate is indeed intermittent, and that the high power outputs are achieved typically between the gates, while lower power outputs are achieved while negotiating the gates. You can see from this slide that power output of this individual goes beyond that associated with the VO2 max. These instances are referred to as supramaximal changes in pace or power output. And you can see in a 14-gate course, 11 of these occurred and are typically associated with deceleration and acceleration while negotiating the gates. As we've seen, there are low power outputs during a slalom run. But what's actually happened during these time periods? Well, the paddler isn't resting. It's at these points that they generate the highest forces in order to negotiate a turning manoeuvre, as shown by the high force peaks on this slide. A closer look at a specific section, i.e. leaving one upstream gate, paddling and negotiating another upstream gate, shows large impulses, which is defined as the force applied over a time for the specific stroke used, in this case a draw stroke, followed by high power outputs during the forwards paddling, but low impulses, and then a repeat of the high forces, high impulses on the second upstream. These high impulses are associated with either isometric muscle contractions or very high force, low velocity, concentric contractions. I think this video demonstrates the point perfectly. You can see that the power increases as the paddler builds speed and drops when they are negotiating a turning manoeuvre. It is during the deceleration and the acceleration that forces are highest and require paddler strength or strength endurance. Combining our understanding of work done, muscular contraction and force development to the physiological response shows that both aerobic and anaerobic respiration attacks considerably. The slide here shows the interaction of the energy systems over a competition run and how they relate to work rate. You can see that the paddler starts with a supramaximal effort in terms of the power output. This effort is related to getting the boat up and running. Due to the slow nature of the aerobic system and the rate of contraction, the first 15 to 20 seconds is dominated by anaerobic respiration. Interestingly, the green arrows indicate periods where the paddler holds their breath. This is a typical response to isometric muscular contraction, and here it is associated with high force development for turning the boat in upstreams or similar manoeuvres. The scientific term for breath holding is the Valsalva manoeuvre. It is believed to be the optimal breathing strategy for maximal force development and trunk stabilisation, and as such warrants further investigation in canoe slalom. As the run continues, you can see that there is an increased demand on aerobic respiration. This energy system typically takes 45 to 60 seconds to reach optimal efficiency, and in most paddlers will be enough to sustain constant effort of slalom, apart from the powerful accelerations required to get the boat back to optimal running speed. Understanding the interaction of the data presented here and the ability to perform the technical aspects of the sport are vital to optimal pacing strategies formulated from training background and genetics. The previous data was obtained from flat water trials and as such could amplify specific work rate shown as power output and conceal the strength components presented as force. The power profile shown here is of a race distance training run at New Zealand's National White Water Course. The paddler is New Zealand representative Callan Gilbert, who is currently ranked 22nd in the 2016 World Cup. The profile indicates similar power peaks to the flat water data, but the major difference is the larger number of troughs. These can occur as a result of gate position and or white water features. Interestingly, during these periods, there is greater reliance on the strength components to steer the boat. With our thus far basic understanding of the sport, we can now simplify the key training requirements. The components labelled here need to be developed in conjunction with an understanding of technique. Technique is all dependent on your physical development, and physical development on white water is dependent on your technique. So, as you can see, they go hand in hand. Anyway, you need to have an understanding of the technique along with an individual's overall levels of training, fatigue, and the associated well-being for the athlete. What we are going to look at today is a generic plan leading in to the events shown here. Before we start, I'd like to highlight some of my own philosophical points that I use to keep me honest in the process ahead. Point one, the difference between personal goal attainment and not in terms of training impulse is marginal. Verging on the side of caution usually produces much better results. Point two, always take a break after a major goal. Starting a new goal slightly overweight with reduced fitness levels and motivated is more sustainable than the alternative. The main thing here is to identify the aim of each training session. Will the paddler or paddlers achieve it without affecting their development technically or physically, and are they motivated for it? Belief and individual ownership are vital for a successful relationship and outcome. It requires persistent interaction between all of those people involved in order to develop a successful plan. This is reiterated in point five. Point six. I've included this because many athletes and coaches try to separate and train the sports components individually. The key with developing an enjoyable program is to develop every facet of the sport as you go. Taking all of what we have done thus far, we need to know how to apply or structure this information. There are two common approaches to this. The first is periodization, which is my preferred route. Typically presented as building an athlete like building a pyramid, it's about how tall we get the pyramid. Common sense or experience with building blocks as children tells us that the bigger the base, the taller the pyramid. However, while this is important, it needs to be put into context of the sport's demands and the time frame available to athletes. In this case, I think it's about 21 weeks. The base of our pyramid is seen possibly as the most boring phase for the slalom paddler. And you can see that the very bottom of that base starts off with a post-season break. Very important that the athlete comes back to training feeling fresh and motivated. The base typically includes a number of components of endurance, strength, and strength endurance. Many people like to separate the stages of the pyramid with breaks, but I prefer mini breaks throughout each period of training. Typically, most athletes I've worked with can deal with 3-week periods, but I'm told that others from different sports cope with 6 weeks before they require a recovery period. Again, this is individual preference, but it has to be dictated by the athlete in terms of them staying fresh and motivated to produce the best in terms of the training they're doing. As it suggests, our mid phase is potentially, or is, the hardest phase physically and mentally. So there's going to be high volumes of training, there's going to be increased intensity, okay, and this is going to put a lot of stress on the athlete. And it's important during this phase that both athlete and coaches are monitoring this and reduce the training if required or provide rest days to recuperate. The tip of the pyramid is referred to as the race phase. This phase may, in our example, is going to last up to 6 weeks, but the whole point of it is to allow the athlete to freshen up, to feel good, to sharpen up, okay, and during this period they're going to perform some high quality training, lower volume, but as a result they'll go into races feeling motivated and hopefully will produce their better results. However, it is important for the athlete to be aware that when they feel fresh, they may misjudge their pacing over race distance. So it is essential that during this phase, they become familiar with what they can hold over a whole race distance. An alternative to periodization is the block training system. As it says here, it's not my favourite method, but you can see that during this system, the athlete and the coaches work on all the aspects required by the sport from week 1 to week 21. At this point, I'm going to stop here. I'm not going to cover any more on block training as we're not using it. Feel free to use any of the information provided in this presentation to actually produce your own block training system along with your coach. In order to get closer to our goal of planning the training, we need to attach labels to training sessions. You can call them what you like, but I have labelled them as such. The first thing to point out here is that all of the percentages associated with heart rate and or work rate are guidelines. It is likely that such values will differ for each paddler and as individuals' fitness levels improve. If you are working with high level athletes or have such facilities available, it is always useful to have a regular and reliable testing system in place. For those who don't have access to such equipment, some crude testing and a good understanding of pacing over courses of different lengths could be helpful. Again, as per the percentage maximum guidelines, the recovery periods need to be based around individual needs. If performed as presented, they should work, but if intensity is too hard or easy, then these recovery periods will need to be adjusted appropriately. The bottom of our pyramid will be filled with the strength and endurance components, and as we get closer to our goal, the intensity or work rate of the key sessions will become progressively harder while recovery periods increase. As you will see, many of the recommended sessions will have considerable crossover. This is unavoidable in slalom, where the variable of interest in regards to effort shifts from power to force dependent on the technical requirement. In this respect, the lag in heart rate to respond to rapid fluctuations mean it's an easier gauge to follow. However, as the paddler becomes more familiar with power output, the average value presented becomes useful in real time. If you are a high-level athlete or have facilities, it is worth monitoring such indices of performance, as it can help determine whether fitness and/or technique is improving. Combining the program developer's philosophy with the number of weeks available, in this case the performance squad's training camps and the races on the New Zealand calendar, gives us a basic structure to work to. Paddlers involved with the National Performance Squad's training camps are advised to ease off training in the week leading up to the camps. Athletes that do this will maximise the camp benefits, but also reduce the chance of overload. Combining these two things enables the developer now to assign training goals to blocks of weeks. In the example provided, you can see the base gets 9 weeks, the mid phase 6 weeks, and the performance phase 6 weeks. If I had more time available for the training program, the plan might only slightly change in that I could give more time to the base endurance and strength sections. However, monotony takes its toll after about 6 weeks in this kind of training. Again, 6 weeks seems from experience to be optimal at the top end of the pyramid, and athletes often require a rejuvenating break following periods of competition. I guess the limitation with what you see here is that it has the potential to be quite routine. With routine comes limited gains, so it's up to the paddler and the coach to make sure the training session content is varied in terms of the water, movement patterns, intensity of training, and the volume of the training. The next step is to provide some guidelines with regards to frequency of training and specific content. I'll show you the whole plan in this format and then break it down into the pyramid layers. Here we have the base work. I recommend 6 to 7 easy endurance sessions per week. I don't advocate specificity and in fact believe cardiovascular benefits may be greater with some cross-training. However, at least 4 sessions should be paddling and include short efforts at race pace. This will help with muscle and neuromuscular memory or maintenance at specific race pace. The graph here shows a typical easy session performed in a continuous manner but including 5 laps of straight line paddling combined with 2 to 3 minutes in the gates. What you do in the gate section is vital, and I like to set limits based on the number of upstreams completed. I also advocate the ups should be done with near maximal force. Therefore, this session develops endurance and sport specific strength. You can see from the graph how power and thus force is quite variable once in the gated sections. This is highlighted in the magnified section. Within this session, the paddler performed a total of 20 upstream manoeuvres. I believe it is important to make every upstream different, and so the courses are varied every time the paddler comes to the gated section. The effect of this are twofold. You do not overload particular muscles in the same way, as this could lead to injury. But more importantly, the paddler is maximising neuromuscular stimulation and thus response to the training effect. In returning to our base period training, you can see that I also suggest 3 supplementary or strength development sessions per week during this period. In considering the previous slide, athletes and coaches need to keep a keen eye on muscle overload. As such, non-sport specific exercise routines might be beneficial if someone already does a lot of gait work on flat, moving or white water. On the water gym sessions can be viewed just like doing weights in a gym, only involve specific strokes. An example of this could be a paddler performing a figure of eight sequence, so they complete 6 upstream gates, 3 on the left and 3 on the right. This would be deemed as one set, which would require full recovery before the next effort. The session could include a total of 6 sets of such exercise, and it is recommended, unlike in this video, that the paddler only works the upstream gates. This session can be performed on flat water, moving water or white water. Moving on to the next phase of our base layer, we still promote low level cardiovascular endurance with 3 to 4 easy paddles a week, plus a bit of a longer one. This doesn't have to be a slalom related paddle. An example could be going surfing in a boat or even on a board, or going on a river trip with family and friends. Also, there is the continuation of the supplementary work from the previous phase. The main difference in this phase is the addition of the higher intensity endurance or threshold training, which will promote greater cardiovascular and muscular endurance gains. Here's an example of a threshold session. It's 2/3 gait work, so the power is variable, but you can see from the power plot that it's pretty constant from effort number 1 to effort number 6. However, you'll notice that the heart rate plot is somewhat different. There is a trend for a gradual rise throughout the session. If the paddler trained by heart rate and not power, the power plot would be the inverse of the heart rate seen here, i.e. high for the first effort and gradually decreasing. Keeping overall work rate constant based off physiological testing is one of the benefits of training by power. Additional to the development of the base layer, we start to introduce the paddler to performance sessions. These come in the form of race endurance and mixed sessions, including threshold and race pace efforts. The race endurance sessions have sufficient crossover to develop maximal endurance, strength and technique, but have sufficient recovery periods to make it more performance orientated than interval or maximal endurance sessions introduced later. The short but high quality nature of the race efforts following thresholds add interest but also help develop neuromuscular, technical and psychological aspects of the sport. It's important here that paddlers get a realistic feel for race pace rather than working too hard or going too fast. Maybe this is the benefit of performing the threshold efforts before the race-based efforts. It's also imperative that the paddler introduces a one-shot mentality to the courses set during these performance sessions. This will start to help ingrain skills such as course rehearsal and dealing with technical imperfections. One of the key aspects of slalom racing and training is how the paddler deals with errors. If mistakes are made during these sessions, quick resolution on the fly is vital and promotes greater training response. I guess the previous period and our next period of training smoothly merge with regards to difficulty and potential stress applied to the paddler. With this in mind, it is vital that both athlete and coach take a realistic view to the athlete's overall fatigue levels. Being able to differentiate between acute and chronic fatigue is very important. If an athlete ventures into chronic fatigue status, then their season or large chunks of their season could well be over. Thus, verging on the side of caution is very useful. Allow the athlete to recover, rejuvenate and absorb the training that they have performed. If a paddler takes a rest day and still has sore or aching muscles, then they may need longer. Okay, the mid phase of training was touted as the hardest period. It still consists of 2 to 3 easy paddles to maintain the cardiovascular endurance previously worked upon. But as you can see, I now suggest performing these paddles prior to some performance efforts over 20 to 30 second time periods. We still have our 2 to 3 quality sessions per week. The first is what I originally referred to as interval, but can also be considered maximal endurance. These sessions are the topping on the cardiorespiratory endurance cake. The purpose of these sessions is to increase the maximum amount of oxygen the muscles consume and use whilst canoeing or kayaking. If sessions are performed specifically, i.e. in slalom gates, there are many valuable crossover training stimuluses to be gained. Here's an example of an interval or maximal endurance session. The intensity of this session is sufficient enough for the paddler to include some short but hard efforts at the warm-up. Again, while this prepares the body for the session to come, it's important not to go too hard and affect pace judgment in the early part of the main session. We have already mentioned the similarity or differences of this session compared to the race endurance session. The reduction of the recovery period means the paddler has spent a total of more than 10 minutes above 85% heart rate max. This is very good and meets the aims of the session perfectly. Paddlers might be recommended to set easier courses or perform this session on slightly smaller water to enable them to achieve the right effect. This training, due to the length of effort and comparatively short recovery periods, should come with a warning. Too much equals overtraining. The scientific research has shown that 6 such sessions are optimal in a period of training as presented here. The second session is a mix of race and race endurance efforts as previously described as performance training. For many, the actual work rate of the interval or maximal endurance session will be very similar to that of the race endurance session presented within this session. However, the main difference is the emphasis on quality, and this is achieved through increasing the recovery periods between efforts. Session 3 gets an optional tag. We must remember that all sessions are optional, and the aim of whether its commencement or completion will enhance performance should always be considered. However, here it is suggested that the paddler could compete in a race or perform a race simulation of 2 runs of race distance separated by at least an hour. Thus, it is very high quality considering the accumulative fatigue of the previous training loads. Athletes are encouraged to use this session to rehearse and fine-tune their competition preparation for the big events to come. The last part of this period of training is the maintenance of supplementary strength or strength endurance. If the athlete is already undertaking large amounts of white water training or is particularly struggling with the training load, this should potentially be the first item on the list to go. Alternatively, you could consider reducing the number of white water sessions, as this may be more beneficial to the other white water sessions that the paddler is undertaking, and thus reduce the chance of specific muscle overload. Okay, we're coming to the end. The point of time where the athlete wants to be at their best. Remember that slalom is a highly technical and physical activity. Paddlers who have undertaken too hard a training program will be physically tired and mentally drained. Volume and intensity have to be monitored. Too much low intensity, high volume leads to stalemate and demotivation. Too much high intensity, high quality work leads to errors in pace judgment. A combination of both is possibly even more disastrous. It's during this phase that all paddlers would like to be able to perform like Yuri here on the Prague World Cup course. However, for those that have done too much training, the likelihood of a lot of mistakes and not being able to correct those mistakes is quite high. This part of the pyramid is split into 2. The first part still focuses on training, but there are now more easy or recovery sessions and less performance sessions. As before, make the performance sessions count, so space them out during the week and perform them on quality white water. I've talked quite a bit about monotony of training, which comes in many guises, including volume, intensity, types of sessions. I believe the key here is to keep the athlete sharp and shake everything up to produce maximal gains. At the same time, the added bonus is that the small stimulus will maintain the work done to this point. At least 2 of the easy sessions here should have some performance efforts attached. I've provided numbers, but in reality, the athlete or athletes need to understand if or when there is any benefit to completing a certain amount. You may do two of these efforts and think, wow, I'm going really well, and end it there. Remember, the aim is to start to feel good in this period of training. That means shake off the fatigue from the previous training loads. And as such, non-sport specific and fun activities may help with this in the easy sessions training. Quite often, by the time athletes get to the main goal of the year, they are demotivated, tired, looking forward to a break, or worse, injured. This suggests they have been unfortunate enough to have overtrained. The key now is to do just the right amount or slightly too little, so when race day comes, you are still keen. Again, be aware, some people, if too fresh, will misjudge pace and go too hard. Training sessions of shorter than race distance need to be kept realistic in terms of the pace that will get you to and through the technical stuff at the bottom of the course. Hopefully, from following these guidelines and recommendations, everybody achieves what they set out to. Enjoy the break. This lecture set out to provide an overview of one slalom coach and sports scientist's perspective on training a New Zealand slalom paddler for the 2017 season. Hopefully you understand the information presented here was not representative of what any individual should or did or will do, but should rather act as sound but flexible guidelines. As such, you may feel that certain aspects have not been given enough attention or lack sufficient explanation. If so, use the YouTube forum or contact me directly. Thanks for listening.